Does the National Film Board of Canada, is there a differentiation between the English-speaking and the French-speaking? Do they?
There is. Yeah. There is. Yeah. There's English program and French program.
It's like two studios in one big National Film Board.
So is the money split evenly between the two? Or?
I'm not sure.
It's a good question.
We try not to know these things.
We don't know about
we just
that.
Want to make films.
Yeah. Yeah. It's, you know, in Canada, there's the expression, the two solitudes, which means the two languages. And I guess the National Film Board is a microcosm of that. But I think they're trying to change that. They're trying to unify it more.
Yeah, like my film was co-produced by studio, English and French studio. And it's not happening often. But in my case, it's work.
Yeah.
So when you guys have an idea to do a film, is it the first place you go? NFB or?
Yeah.
For us, yes, definitely.
But we, you know, Wendy and I have been working with the film board for a very long time, 20 years, I guess. Mm-hmm. And so we have a good long-standing relationship with them, and they've done very well by us. That's how it works, right? We've done very well by them. Mm-hmm. Something. Yeah. Maybe it's mutual.
Just a balanced relationship over years and years.
Yeah.
Well, there's really nowhere else you can make a film like ours that's a short film of your own design that's not necessarily going to make a profit, that you have the support of producers, and there's even in Montreal, there's a big building that is where the headquarters is, and there's actually, there are recording studios in there, mixing studios. It's a fantastic place to make a film.
Patrick came in on a really good program they have called Hot House, where they do, they get young filmmakers in to do minute-long films, which is a great thing, because often when young filmmakers come to the film board, they're thinking, I have to make a masterpiece, and they get kind of hamstrung by that. And so this is, you know, minute-long thing is a great introduction, isn't it?
Yeah, and it releases pressure for my new project.
Yeah.
Mm. So, I was with Hot House. They learn you all the process to from the beginning to the end of the production. So for my new project Sunday, I know everything what was going on.
Mm-hmm. You know how things work, the lay of the land.
Take some of the awe off it. You know, you're not as awed as you are when you first go in there.
And yeah, for your question, the National Film Board of Canada is the better place, I think, to do an animated short film. If you want to make it, to make a film daughter, it's the better place.
So what made you think of being an animated film director in the first place?
Sorry, if I missed the question.
What made you want to do this job?
I always draw as a kid, and at Montreal there's a place called Cinematheque where they are screening a lot of short animated film. So it was like a university, and I felt in love with that kind of medium, and so it was the better way to tell the story for me.
Did your parents say, great idea, be an animated filmmaker? Do shorts.
Maybe not. It was not a good idea. But they are very open, so it was nice. It was okay for them.
Okay. And you guys said, we want a career in shorts. That's our...
Yeah. Well, the film board, you know, there's such a great... catalog of really fantastic short animated films that it seems quite credible, you know, that's the thing to do. But for both Wendy and me, we started out in live action, and then I think we were attracted to the sort of more contained world of animation, especially, you know, the kind we do as a short film. You can pretty much do it by yourself or with a very small crew, and I think we like the control and the containment. You don't have to go out on shoots in the rain, which is what we did a lot, going to art school in Vancouver. Mm-hmm. And
so we went to art school together.
Yeah.
But neither of us actually went there thinking we would do animation.
No.
We sort of fell into that and for me, it was my final project was animated. Mm. So then that went to some festivals, and then I ended up going to Montreal and making films there. And but it, yeah, it's the, I think the medium of short films is attractive for people probably like the three of us who like a kind of solitude in the process. And I mean, live action filmmaking is great, but it is very collaborative and in some ways diluted. It's mm-hmm. It tends to get hierarchical, and the roles are divided up. Whereas with this, we get to do everything. We're in charge of it all.
We're not team players, is what we're really saying.
We like power.
Control.
Yeah.
We are control freaks.
We are control freaks. Yeah.
Definitely. And you guys are a team.
Yes,
which is not usual. It's not.
So are there claw marks underneath your hairline?
Heavy makeup. We do really well, and I think we have a very sympathetic view of most things, and so then that way we can do it. So I'm grateful for that. I really like being a team, despite the fact that we both like to run things. There's a lot of we're just copacetic.
Is there something where you said, okay, this is I it's good to have a second person to do these things that I don't like doing, or is it that you just there's a lot of work and you found a way to make it work together?
Well, I think it's both things. Yeah. There's a really nice thing that happens in a good partnership where one person can be feeling weak and snivelly, and the other person will rise to the occasion and be strong for that period of time. And you know you're in trouble if you're both down, but that's not very often. You can get through a lot of stuff with two people. And it's just mm-hmm. nice to have the companionship. You know, for stuff like this, it's nice to have somebody else. This poor dude's all on his own.
Yeah.
Well,
he's got you now.
Oh, he's got us. Yeah.
Yeah, because it takes a long time to finish the production, and there's a lot of up and down,
and boredom.
Yeah,
and
lots boredom. Of boredom, yeah.
And it's difficult when you are down to get up, because and in animation it's difficult to anticipate what's going on. You know, you're trying to guess what kind of reaction audience can have. Mm-hmm. But for animation, you have to work on each scene. In live action, you can do a previous editing with some stuff, and you can anticipate. In animation, right. It's difficult to do that.
Yeah, gotta slog it out. Yeah.
Mm. But you must kind of enjoy that part of it. The boredom must be part of the pleasure on some level.
We listen to a lot of podcasts and books.
Music.
We listen to books, audiobooks, and mm-hmm. that sort of
it's,
thing. And
there's
sort of
there's
a pleasure in the kind of you get kind of zen, I think, mm-hmm. where you're just working on it and where you're not actually thinking about it. You're just coloring something. But I think Patrick was saying, it's hard to keep the whole film in your head over a period of years, mm-hmm. and you lose sight of it, and then I think it comes together more at the end. Well, in our case, we're editing all the way through, but when you start getting music and sound, more of the final sound, it starts to seem like a real film to you. But it's, you know, an idea that you start 1 year, and if it takes several years to make it, the idea becomes old, and you have to keep it fresh. You have to find ways to still have faith in the project.
So what does it feel like when you're done?
It's terrible. for me, it's a process of diminishing possibilities. Mm. And when I finish it, it's like I can't change anything anymore. And it is what it is, and it doesn't resemble the film I thought it was going to be at the beginning.
Mm. Well, you're really sick of it,
it's like your child is out on the world in the world on its own, and you can't control it anymore, and you have to say goodbye. Have a good life.
How did you feel when you finished it?
I was just happy to finish the film.
Yeah.
I don't care about the reaction. I was just happy to finish the film, and it's done. And after that, you learn to appreciate your film. because at the end, you don't like it very, very much.
No.
You get reacquainted with it, I think, afterwards, right?
Yeah. And you know that there's a, it's not a perfect film, but you can appreciate more after a few weeks after.
Or years.
Yeah, or years, yeah.
So how quickly did you go from finishing films to showing films?
Well, this wildlife, it sat in the can for 6 months, I think, before they decided to release it in the spring to try to hit some of the European festivals, which it didn't get into anyway. So that was...
Was it an FBI decision?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they wanted to sort of wait for some of the big springtime festivals. And so that was weird, just having it sitting there in the void for all those months. We built up quite an enormous insecurity about it. So, yeah. And you did your
skills? I finished the film in September 2010. Mm-hmm. And the first festival was in February. So it's weird to wait, and we don't know the reaction, and it's weird.
Yeah.
It's
weird.
So did you go on to your next film while that was happening, or did you kind of getting over the last one?
Well, we took it seems like we only had like a month off, and then we started doing some commercials. So we've been doing commercials for about a year now, and we're ready to start another film now.
Yeah, we're tired though. It's, you know, you really put in a big push in that last bit. And you just think, I'm never gonna make another animated film as long as I live.
it took some time to
recover.
Yeah. And for me, I'm doing illustration, so between films, I'm doing illustration to win my life. Mm-hmm. And so maybe later in the year I will begin a new script for an animated short film.
So is that how short film animators make their living, is by going off and doing commercials or illustrating books?
Because it's difficult to align a lot of animated short film.
It takes
I cannot do that.
And we're all freelancers. There was a time at the National Film Board when they had filmmakers on staff, so you would be like a tenured filmmaker, and you would just finish one and then you would start another one, but that doesn't exist anymore. So we're freelancers, so when we're finished and we have to make a living until the next one. And I mean, we're lucky that we can find other work.
Yeah, really lucky.
Is there a holy grail for short filmmakers?
Well, this could be it.
Yeah. Is there a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow?
Well,
that's what I'm saying. Is there ever like a big cash payoff for being a short filmmaker?
I don't think so. Not that I know of. You know, interesting things come your way, but they don't necessarily make a lot of money. And I think people assume often that you are secretly yearning to do a feature film, which we are not secretly yearning to do. Really, it's
overtly yearning.
We're not yearning anyway.
Not yearning of any kind. Okay.
Yeah, it's
especially
not
animated. That would just be a nightmare. longer than this one.
But opportunities, you know, you sort of have to see what comes up. But there's nothing that I would anticipate coming out of this film that would be better than a nomination. Mm-hmm. It gives you opportunities to do commercials and that kind of thing, or possibly, you know, an animated segment of a TV show or something like that. And so I think you can have some good opportunities, but it's not like you can start planning your retirement.
So it's kind of a choice to be an artist, to be a short filmmaker.
Yeah, well, we're lucky we have that choice, because the film board helps us have that choice, you know.
Right. It's not possible anywhere or
everywhere. It's anywhere else,
It's not the kind of thing you can do when you get home from work, you know. You have to put in a lot of hours, and, you know, I always envy writers who, you know, even writers with multitudes of children, all they have to do is get up at 5 a.m. and they write until 8, and then they're done for the day. You know how some writers talk about that, this sort of very compressed work period. I'm so jealous.
Well, it really is hard work. It's not exactly heavy lifting, but it is.
It's work. Hard work. It's Yeah.
People as the impression that it is funny or
and it is
not funny. It's difficult.
And they always think we're wacky. Yeah. You know, the wacky animators. Yeah, we're not wacky either. It's.
No.
Is it funny when you're writing it?
Yeah, writing is fun. I think it is when you animate the film that it's
not funny.
Yeah, it's more difficult.
Well,
writing find Heidi and this is the fun part, and I think for myself it is important during the production that to find new Heidi and to be alone, to work alone. It's allow that you can find new ID and you don't have to ask to somebody else the opinion. You just make it and that's okay.
Yeah.
So where did your first idea of this idea come from?
The original ID of the film?
Mm-hmm.
It's based from my memories, memories of my Sunday when I was a child, and this is boring Sunday when you accompany your parents at the church and your grandparents, and the kids in the film the kid uses imagination to escape the boredom of of his day. So yeah, this is the original idea for the film.
So the next film could be about this interview for you.
Yeah.
Oh, I tease. Myself. And for you guys?
Ours comes from a historical thing. There were these guys that came from England around the turn of the 20th century, and they were usually sons of aristocracy. And they had sort of, just by changes in British society, lost their place. So they had nowhere to go, and they were hanging around and getting in trouble usually. So they were often sent to the colonies to, you know, tame it or some such noble thing. And they
pretend to tame it.
Yeah.
And civilize it, yeah.
A lot of them really just horsed around. You know, they got a remittance from home, and they would drink it and play polo and badminton. And they had no intention of farming often, and they were not really educated for it. They weren't really built for it. They didn't know anything about it.
They were kind of useless.
They're kind of useless. And so that was kind of the original. We became intrigued by these characters who were almost completely forgotten as a part of our history, even though it's, you know, less than 100 years ago. But also because both Wendy and I had grandparents who came from England, not as remittance men and not as aristocracy, but they came out with this sort of ideal notion about farming. And they just got their butts kicked.
They idealized Canada as this land of golden opportunity, and it was not that. It was, I mean, I guess there was opportunity, but you had to be able to, you had to, you know, it took more than education and breeding to survive.
Well, they also hit the Depression too, you know, they really had a rotten time. So it's in our memory banks, that, you know, the family memory of these kinds of hardships are there for both of us.
Mm-hmm. And how did that develop into a fuller idea?
Well, it's not that much fuller.
Well, it's interesting, the juxtaposition of things in the film. And
yeah.
I mean, it's not as straight narrative about cowboy, British cowboy.
No, I think Amanda had the idea originally a long time ago, possibly for a feature script, live action. And it was something that I kind of wanted to do. After we finished our previous film, I kind of wanted to do something documentary, or more experimental, actually. And but then we were thinking, well, no, animated. But then I sort of thought that this film, this idea might be good as a faux documentary, and just sort of make fun of not really make fun of the documentary thing, but there's something anachronistic about interviewing people in a documentary in another time when there was no such thing as cameras, you know, talking heads on cameras. So that was mm-hmm. part of the idea. But we also wanted to just take this historical time and place and this character and tell a story, but with very few strokes. So just take moments from his life and the trajectory of his existence on the prairies, taking it through the seasons. And mm-hmm. I mean, that's the thing about animation, is that you can tell a story without going into great detail, a lot of backstory, the kind of things you do in feature films, you don't do. So you have to very carefully choose what you show. And that was kind of the interesting challenge, was just to make it almost a meditation on, you know, the rise and fall of this one character.
Mm-hmm. So is part of the issue when you think of an idea like this to avoid having too much? To pare it down before you?
Well, so it's just a lot of work. You don't want to have too much.
Right.
And then sometimes you end up animating a lot. We tend to animate more than we use, which is stupid as an animator. But do you?
I threw away a lot of animated scene.
Huh.
Not complete, but a rough animation.
Mm-hmm.
Because sometimes
just doesn't work the way you want it to.
We thought that it's a good idea, so I animated, and after that I realized no, it's bad. It's a bad idea. So
it's too bad you have to do all that work.
Yeah. But that's okay.
Mm-hmm. And you don't really know until the end of the process that it's working, really, do you?
Not really.
that's the disturbing part of it, but also the really nice part when, you know, people give you these very specific comments in response to the film, mm-hmm. where it just makes you feel so good to know that this thing that you struggled with is actually communicating,
mm-hmm.
and you get, you know, an interesting variety of comments, and starts to add up to the decision that maybe you did communicate the way you wanted to.
Mm.
And what's the process with all this award stuff, this Academy Award stuff that you guys are, you know, suffering through this week? I mean, is it does NFB submit everything, or is there a selection process within the films that are made every year? Or
I think there's a selection process.
Yeah. I'm not sure. Maybe, I don't know.
They've got this great publicity department and the festivals department that does all the furious submitting to festivals and four-walling for the Oscars, and it's out of our hands at that point. It's really luxurious for us, you know, to just say, have your way with it, you know.
So when did you know that you were in contention?
Well, we knew our films were being submitted, and then we were...
There was the long list in November. And after that, it was in the December the short list.
We were still
there.
And now we're still there.
Yeah.
So how was the long list? When you hear that you're on the long list, is that...
That's nice.
That was very nice,
So then that goes on, and you know, it was about 2 months, wasn't it? Almost 2 months mm-hmm. that we were on that, and you... start getting kind of anxious. I mean, the last time Wendy and I were nominated in 1999, and I don't think we, or 2000, and we didn't really have a concept of the long list, and then you realize it just kind of adds to your agony. You know?
I mean, this year there was a lot more publicity around the long list. They decided, I think the Academy decided to publish it mm-hmm. more widely, and so the three of us were sort of in a there, particularly in Canada, there were news stories about two films, you know, shortlisted for Oscar, you know, and then of course people are writing and relatives are calling and saying, "You've been nominated." And we're saying, "No, we haven't been nominated," you know, because they would miss the bit about the shortlist, and so.
Well, then there's not supposed to be any publicity around the shortlist. You're not supposed to talk about it in any kind of official way.
Yeah. So it was strange.
Nice, but strange.
So different this year than it was the first time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because of that.
Oh, yeah.
A lot
yeah.
more fuss. A lot more.
So then when you go from the long list to the short list, how's that moment?
Well, that's... Yeah, it's the short list that really...
That's great. Yeah, it's so nice to...
Or is that... Are we talking about the nomination now?
No, I'm sorry. We're talking about the nomination.
Well, you start with the long list, right?
Okay,
so and then you get to the short list.
Yeah.
And then you get to the really short list.
The nomination list.
Yeah.
That's great. That's
fun with the short list because you can try to predict what's going on after what will be the five nominated films.
Did you predict your film?
Sorry?
Did you predict your film?
I was expecting one of the NFB films, but not two.
And yeah, that was a great surprise. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So it's nice.
But the nomination is great. The nomination is the big prize as far as I'm concerned.
And how was that this time?
Well,
did somebody call you? Do you just watch on the internet or TV?
We got up and we watched on the internet, and you did too, right?
Yeah.
Because we knew that if we were nominated, we'd get a call, and it's 6:30 in the morning, and so then you're thinking, well, if I don't get up, then I'm going to be lying there awake thinking, why aren't they calling? So we just got up, and of course we're very happy. And then you don't know what to do with yourself because it's 6:30 in the morning.
The phone did start ringing immediately.
Yeah.
And what was your nomination morning like?
I was with my girlfriend and my daughter, and we checked the conference press.
Mm-hmm.
After that, we checked the on the computer the nomination, and I saw my name, and we screamed.
Yeah, so did we.
But my girl didn't understand because she is 2 years old, so she was crying.
What's wrong?
She's crying.
What's going on?
You scared your daughter.
Yeah.
That's funny.
But it's a great moment. Yeah.
And have you all picked your outfits for the big show, or?
We have.
They're in progress.
So you have something made for you, or?
A designer in Calgary, Paul Hardy, is doing Wendy's and my dresses.
With boots? No boots?
No boots.
But everything in Calgary, for some reason, I think you have to wear boots.
I know.
Maybe we should. Like cowboy boots?
You could start a whole new trend.
Yeah.
Oh.
Sure.
Red carpet. You could wear boots too.
Oh yeah,
it would be more comfortable.
That's true.
Yeah.
French boots. And have you purchased a tuxedo or are you?
Yeah, I went. I saw a designer last week, and we chose everything. He took my measurement, and next week I will try it and make adjustment. So yeah, it would be nice.
So you look perfect.
Yeah, I won't.
And do you have any advice for him having to do this for the first time?
Oh, he's doing great.
I'm just envious that he gets to wear a suit.
It's simpler.
Yeah.
You could wear spark.
I know I could. I've thought about it, but it's just, you know.
Yeah, it's more complicated.
It's more complicated.
I don't think we have any advice for you. Have we given you any advice?
He doesn't need our advice.
I don't think he needs it.
And so when this happens, do you get a hand out from the animation universe in Los Angeles and Seattle and around, or is it?
Well, yeah, you get acknowledgement for it for sure. People are usually pretty excited. You know, the short animation film world is small, and people are very excited, which is nice. You know, it's a pretty tight bunch. Very nice group of people, actually. I feel lucky to have the community we do.
So the people from Kung Fu Panda 3 aren't going, hey, maybe you should be doing Kung Fu Panda 3.
No, they're different. They're different.
Yeah.
Bunch.
It's not the same kind of people. No, they're nice, but it's not the same kind of vision.
Yeah, it's not a natural jump to go from what we do. I mean, it could happen. Like Toro Cove, I think, is directing a feature right now. She won the Oscar a few years ago. And she's a colleague of ours at the NFB, but we've had so many nice emails from people within the animation world and other worlds, I guess. You know, it's just so nice to be recognized in that way. But I don't, I was thinking, like, if you were a director of a feature film,
right,
or if you were an actress, I think a nomination, you know, really means a huge difference. I mean, economically, I'm sure it's like millions of dollars in a film's life, or, you know, if you're an actress, you get another role. just like that. For us, it's not a huge...
A little more subtle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It certainly doesn't... There's not a pot of gold, as you said, you know, waiting for us. We're not in this for the money. But we just hope interesting opportunities.
Yeah.
It does open more doors, I think.
No secret handshake.
Not that we're going to talk about.
Yeah. Who told you?